First of all, a quick presentation of myself. I come from the University of Rome, so big. I work in a department of computer science, about 20 associate professors, 32 professors, let's say 60 professors at home. I come from the database area, and I'm slowly moving from visual data into information visualization, visual informatics, and recently moved in the visual analytics world, and now I'm moving in information retrieval world. This is the outline of my talk. There is a big part that is just an introduction about visual analytics. I suppose that you are not aware of that, and I will try to explain you what visual analytics is. And I will show you a couple of examples. One that is just methodological, one that is about visual analytics and information that is specific for that. And I provide a demo. So, what about information visualization? It's an old story, of course. Human beings are using visualization for presenting any kind of things like this. And the problem is that information visualization can be used for three different purposes. One is problem solving. I'll give you three historical examples of that. In London, 184, a big epidemic of cholera was killing people. And the reason of that was not known. And doctors knew, a doctor, had the idea of drawing a map of the London part in which dots are indicating people that died. And the crossing are representing water pump. And analyzing this visualization, doctors knew come up with the idea that there is a high concentration of that in this part of London. And this pump is really suspicious, has been contaminated by cholera. Closing the pump resolved the problem. And now, in that place, in that place, there is a pub that is still presenting the doctor's new picture, remembering that there is. So, problem solving. Another possibility is using visualization for explaining things. Of course, all of you are aware of the Russian campaign of Netflix. It was not a success, of course. But let us try to present it the result. This map has been done by Maynard in 2016. And just quickly give you the idea. The size of this flow represents the number of soldiers. This is the soldiers that are going inside Russia. Black means retiring. Black. This is the amount of people entering in Russia. This is the number of people exiting from Russia. That gives you a quick understanding of what is going on. You can recognize some part in which people, there are battles, quick reducing the number of people and so on. So you can use visualization for explaining something that you know. Or, you need to make a decision. You are in London again, modern time, actual time. And you are in the metro. You want to get to the Queen Park station from Victoria Station. How you can do that? Very easy. Take the map. This is the old map of the London Underground. Not really useful. But, an employee of the London company, underground, had an idea to distort the map. Because the real position does not matter when you are traveling underground. What does matter is the connection. So he got the idea of having a new map, but the London underground was not sure about the idea. And he got a very little amount of money. And this is the actual map used, and this kind of maps are used worldwide. It's a distortion, much used. So we have three different ideas, understanding, making decision, and explaining for visualization. But let's move to the present time. This is on the paper. Now information visualization is on computer. And what is visualization? Visualization means to have a mental model of something. It's a cognitive activity. Nothing to do with the computers. And this is the definition of information visualization that I really like. Information visualization is the use of computer supported, that's mandatory nowadays, interactive misrepresentation of abstract data to amplify cognition. I will try to give, I will skip the computer part. We all of us are sure that computers are mandatory. I will try to go in the interactive part to abstract data and amplify cognition with some examples. What is the goal of information visualization? Is when we have not precise idea what we're going to do. Information visualization is perfect for exploring the data when you don't know exactly what you're looking at. And is it very good for explaining complex data and support decision? Of course, information visualization has some other alternatives. There are some historical ideas, data mining, statistics, and so on, well known. But statistics allow for strong verification, but does not support exploration. And data mining is as a question-response style. You already have an idea in your mind. You're just looking for some confirmation of your idea. The point is that no one of this world, infobis or statistics, are strong enough. The idea is to combine them together. This is the basic idea behind visual analytics. But let's be back to information visualization for the moment. Computer supported, that's fine. But remember that the computer is something, and that is a cognitive activity involved in the process. Your brain is involved in the story. Your eyes are involved in it, and so on. And the visualization must be interactive. I'll show you an example. This is a very simple visualization. Some agronomists are comparing the several treatments, antiparasite, fertilizer, and so on, across different crops, corn, tomatoes, potatoes, whatever. And you have a black box, a black doctor representing the success. Treatment A was good for one. Good for tree, good for A, and so on. Did you come up with some general understanding of this visualization? Not so good. But let's try to arrange the rows. We can start from this initial visualization. We can have some interactive activities. So we can come up with this result. And we can easily understand that treatment A and D are very good for 1, 3, and 8. Treatment C, A, G, and D are good for 2, 6, and 10, and so on. So interaction is mandatory, but it is highly exponential. So we need some automatic tool that helps us. Visual analytics can help us in this process. Information visualization is about abstract data. Abstract data means that it's not related with the physical stuff. It's the other side of what is called the scientific visualization, like airflow over the wing, weather, torrents, internal parts of your body, and so on. I give you a quick example. This is a scientific visualization. It is an earthquake intensity in the San Francisco zone. Red means high intensity, yellow means medium intensity, and so on. This is scientific visualization because you are using a real part of the world to present the information. It's not absent, and it comes in the scientific part. Or, if you move to information visualization, we think about abstract data. We are presenting on the screen something that is not a physical counterpart. Just a bit of example, I have a database about postal parcels sent by Deutsche Post across Italy, about 200,000 parcels. And I'm going to visualize it using the volume and the weight of these parcels. This is the visualization. Each single dot represents the parcels, the parcel. Here is the volume. Here there is the weight. You can easily come up with the conclusion that most parcels are equal in life. You can see some patterns here. For instance, this is the usage of the standard boxes. The volume is the same, but the weight changes according to what you put inside. And here there are some clusters. You can go inside to have more understanding what is going on. This is totally abstract because there's no physical correspondence with the real world. This is the basic information visualization I did. And you can have mixed visualization. Here you are representing some traffic on the network, and you can have the data represented by arrows with the intensity of the arrows representing the amount of mobile. But you have also a map on the background that give you the idea of the physical location. So it's something in between. Amplify the mission. That is dramatically important. Visualization amplifies cognition. Why? Because eyes, human eyes, are the highest bandwidth of human interface. It's parallel. You can recognize it easily pattern. And people think visually. The sentence I see means I understand in a lot of ways. Understanding and seeing are very close to each other. And here I have two examples for you. I will wake up you this morning, ask you to answer my questions. And amplified cognition, I'll give you an example, and there are some attentive features. You don't need to reason. You need to involve your brain. Just use your eyes. Now, I have two examples for you. Each example will give you 4 seconds of time to the answer. This is a table, very simple data. The American USA states, Alabama, Alaska, the percentage of college degree, 25%, 20%, 30%, and the money, the per capita income from that state. A very simple data set. And I ask you, please, give me these three answers. Which state has the highest percentage college degree? Please give me the information what is the highest income. And there is a relationship between the college and income. 1, 2, 3, 4 seconds. No answer. Let's change the situation. The answer is here. You can easily get the degree here and the income here. You can easily get the highest income and the highest college degree. And if there is a clear correlation between money and college degree, you can see that dots are across more or less across the line. That means amplifying cognition. You can quickly grasp more idea that in this way. And what about the track 10? I will ask here a very simple question. Again, we have 4 seconds. And we'll show you some numbers. And you have to count how many trees are there. You have 4 seconds. Good. Time is not enough. You can do that in less than 0.2 seconds. Just change the visualization. Color is a protective feature. You can possess color without hearing. You can distinguish things using color without involving the brain. It's computed in the internal part of the cortex between the eyes and the brain. So you can do that in a very quick way. So, a lot Toronto, these issues are totally clear. But most of the people in Europe, then, a lot of bad utilization are now. And it's not enough to do something nice. It is to do something right, using a lot of already known ideas and results. Okay, just to give you a quick understanding of what is the state of the art of visualization, there are two canonical steps. You move from the data to internal representation. That means dealing with the univariate data, bivariate, and so on, encoding the relationship, temporal data, maps, diagram, graph tree, data stream, and so on. That has been already done. It's already available. You no need to invent it. Just take a book. This is just a sketch of what is around to represent the stuff. This is the first step, moving from the data to internal representation. After that, you have to present it on the screen. And this is the second part. From the internal representation, go to the presentation on the screen. And the screen has a limitation. The dimension of the screen is not enough, and so on. So there are some techniques to deal with some limitation. You have scrolling, overview plus details, distortion, suppression, zoom and pan, and so on. There are some well-known and understood and agreed techniques to present on the screen a lot of information. Here, I give you some quick idea. Focus plus context, any different way of handling a lot of stuff. Again here, the situation is very clear. The situation, the story, the field studied this part, we have clear results about that. But we are not invent anything. So, the problem is solved. Typical quantitative data that they're experimenting around. Billions of emails per day, billions of IP packets per day, trillion of web pages, petabytes. And Google possesses 20 petabytes of data every day. Visualization is not enough. And size is important, but also complexity. Important as well. Think of, I will use in my talk data, some ideas, some results coming from the Promise project. But in my mind, it is very close to the FIRE and whatever, the experimental evaluation information system is the same. So, think of the data you use. You have to define, formally define the data. You have metadata. You have about 100 metrics per topic. And you do an experiment. For each topic, you have about 100 metrics, more or less. It's not a big number. But if you go in a shop, you have to choose about among 100 cameras. Not an easy task. Even with a little number, that's 100. And there are some different way of looking at that. You can do an analysis per single topic or per experiment, and so on. And you can move to a higher level. You can look for simple metrics or for aggregate metrics, averaging, and so on. You can do some statistics. And you can do some meta-statistics, correlation, and so on. What I want to stress here, that information retrieval experiment evaluation data, it's not big in a strict sense, but it's complex. The structure is complex. And this is again a problem. Visualytics is not, information visualization are not only for big data, it's also for complex data. This is an important point as well. So, in a lot of situations, people needed to look at the data for the decision to understand what is going on. And there are some automatic analysis, data mining, or manual analysis, information visualization. Two different words. The visual analytics idea is to combine them together, exploiting the advantages of both this kind of approach. Okay, this is the manifesto for visual analytics. What is the idea? You start from the data. You do some transformation of the data, data cleaning, adding new values, and whatever. And you can decide either to visualize the data or to apply some data mining algorithms, clustering, partitioning, or whatever. And while you are, for instance, visualizing, you can interact with the system. Interaction is a key-ish interaction. And maybe you can focus on a subset of the data. You can start some automatic analysis. You can be back to a new visualization. You can go back and forth between visualization and models, visualization models. And sometimes you get some knowledge. You get some insight, you understand some. And in principle, you should be able to add this knowledge to the data set to increase what is going on. This is the basic idea behind the visual analytics. And visual analytics is a very challenging research field because it involves totally different aspects. We have data mining, we have the data management, we have human perception recognition, we have spatial temporal data, a particular brand for visual analytics visualization are intended for time-oriented visualization. And you have a scientific information visualization in the middle. And you have a lot of components, a lot of challenging issues to be dealt with. And among them, one is really important, are human beings. The other side of the screen of your computer is a human being, with the real eyes, with perception, with cognition. And disregarding that, as Microsoft does every day with this software, is a really a bad activity. And I would like to stress this idea and wake up you again, having a little bit of fun with this video. I would like to show you that there are some kind of blindness, something you are not able to notice in visualization, in situation, in different ways. And now I'm going to ask you to answer a question. I will show you a video, a very short video, 20 seconds, 26 seconds of video, in which these guys are going to exchange the ball with each other. Focus your attention on the girl with the white shirt. And please count how many times she receives the ball. Disregarding knocking on the floor or whatever. You're just to count how many times she gets the ball. In coming. Not out coming. Only in coming and not knocking. Is it that clear? Okay. Thank you. did your calculation, that my fault, Nicole. So, who counted the system? Okay? Who seven? The most voted score. But I have another question for you. How many gorillas were in the video?
One.
Two people, three people got the gorilla. Okay. Four people.
Mm.
Five. Okay, you're particularly big in that. Oh, let's go to the video again. And this time, disregard, look at the video. Or to the video. Gorilla. Black? Pushing the left. But you were so involved in looking at this, counting the bulls. You knew the gorilla. Okay, this is called attentional blindness. It's a cognitive problem. It's well known as that. Looks like a joke, but it's not a joke. Can happen to a pilot in a plane controlling the instruments during the flight. And there are other kinds of blindness that you have to be aware of. Just to give you, having some fun, some problems that can come up in these situations. And animation, interaction are key issues to overcome this kind of problem. Okay, now I'll give you an example of visual analytics activity, full coverage of the states. This is still an abstract one. The idea is to, taking a data set, to derive new values for the data set and to visualize them. Assume that you are studying English books. And you want to compare Mark Twain books with the Jack London books, all of that. How can you do that? This is a work done by Daniel Kame and his research group. This is a very active group in Europe and in Constance University. And the idea is that take the book and split it in chunks. A sentence, a page, a paragraph, whatever. Split it in different chunks. For each chunk, measure some relevant feature. The length of the sentence, for instance. The number of different word used. A whatever. Any kind of what of the information you're looking at. In the example, I will use the sentence of the average sentence length, the length of the sentences. And visualize it, associating this new thing with some visual attributes. For instance, color is enough. And visualize it. Okay, here we have a book, books from Jack London, we have a book from Mark Twain. And you can see that in the blue means long sentences, red means short sentences. You can easily see that Jack London typically is oriented towards short sentences, is in this zone of the graph, and is more or less constant in his production. This is a little bit an outlier because it's exactly in the middle. Mark Twain instead last long sentences in all his books. But Tom Sawyer. Tom Sawyer is totally different. I don't know why. But you can come up with the idea that maybe that is not from Jeff Mark Twain or that something is changing here. You can easily come up with this result. And you can see also how the sentence, the length of the sentence is distributed. Mark Twain is For instance, here is the long sentence in the initial part, and it's short up, and it ends with a very short sentence. Very quickly, you can grasp some ideas. Something that reading the book, you will never discover. And interaction allows you to go inside the data. You can click here. This is not uniform. This is a stage point. I can zoom in the data. And I can discover that the long sentences are associated to, you can go to the, kill the original books, of course. This is a report of a naturalist, that's why it's long. This is the dialogue, so it's short because it's just short sentences, that's long. This is the basic idea. Here we are adding some new information, and we are visualizing it with interaction. What about the Bible? It's very easy to see, for instance, that in this part, there is a consistent part of the Bible in which they are used in very short sentences. Maybe it depends on the author. You can have a very quick overlook with it. Long sentences are very seldom. Most of them is in the middle, the white one. But these are very short. They are really, really very short. You can go inside and so on. Just to give you how combining automated analysis and visualization, you can come up with nice results. And again, interaction is mandatory. Okay, just words about the project that I've been involved in. This European, this master project, is a coordinated action. The idea is to build up a community of people in Europe interested in these analytics. And we produced in this, we produced a book. The first book about these analytics has been done in 2005 in USA, after the big terrorist attack. And the focus is basically on overland security. But this analytics is not intended only for that. So our answer, 5 years after, is a new book that is Managing the Information Age, Solving Problems with this analytics. That is available for free. Just look for this master on Google, you can download the book. And it contains all the information about this analytics. And there, the problem is much further. Problem solving, making decision, and so on. The key word is this must. This is what. There is a long page with a link to the book. You can download it for free. Okay. Now, let's try to move to something that is closer to you. I will show you very quickly what is the path that we followed in the promised project using this model. Okay, step one, we have to pre-process the data. What have we done? We worked a lot to have a clear understanding of experimental data. What are the data involved in? We enriched the data. This is the topic, the classical topic table with some statistics for experiment, for instance, you are familiar with it, but we need some metadata. We need the way of grouping data and so on. We define a data structure, what we call a TMP cube, topic, metric, and experiment cube. It's totally formalized. We provide some transformation, how to move from this basic table, topics and metrics. And if you take the average precision, you can move to the mean. We can come up to that. We have the transformation. We have now not a perfect, but a good, quite good understanding and formalization of it. This is important. This is the first step. After that, we go from some visualization. And we define the an architecture, a reference architecture. We start from the data, we extract a table, we enrich this table with some attributes, some of them are hidden, some of them are computed on the fly, and we can start several visualizations coordinated on the same table, integrated together. And we have a set of different visualizations. Some of them are very common. We have scatter plots, stacked bar chart, box plot chart, tables, and so on. And we have some novel visualization for ranking or for data stream and so on. We have to follow two paths. One is to go for the traditional stuff, what used every day. Tables, box plot, scatter plot, bar chart, whatever. Plus some new, and we should do a video about that, some new novel visualization, highly integrated with the interaction. Second point three, define the models and the relationship with the visualization. Here, I don't go in the details. We are hard working on something about evaluating the ranking of a query result. We start the query with the topic, we need to come up with the ranking result. We want to evaluate the quality of it. And in that, we use a visualization, but we're using also some machine learning algorithms. We have clustering and so on. And we have a tight integration between the visualization and automated analysis. That changes each time. This is the core of each application. It depends on the target of your application. Here the target is to evaluate the rank. Not position record, but the rank. And last but not least, we need for some knowledge. But here we are still missing something because we are looking for some expert that is using the system. The system is available on the web, but it's still in the alpha beta stage. It will be ready by the end of the next year, in September and next year. And this is the way in which we are proceeding in progress. And now I have a demo to give you the idea of what we're doing. But I have two chances. Even give you a demo for the actual implemented system that is traditional, showing this kind of traditional stuff. What is just important here is to understand that you can go here to select some dots on this kind of plot, having automatically selected the corresponding part of another visualization. All of them are totally integrated, directly interactive. But this is, let's say, quite traditional. Apart from the fact that it's interactive, automated, and whatever, that is really important. You can come up, you select an experiment, you come up with all the data automatically, you build up quickly this kind of visualization automatically, and you can interact with them, selecting some elements, having the corresponding highlighting on the little one, and so on. But I would like to go towards a more challenging something that is totally new. The idea is to understand the performance of a ranking algorithm. You issue a query with a topic, with a single topic, and you have the result. This is the list of the first 200 retrieved documents. And the color gives you the idea of the position of documents. Red means that the document is above its real position. Blue means it is below, and there is the automatic computation of the discounted weight gains. I suppose you are familiar with it, in which you can use to model the quantity of information used to retrieve from browsing the ordered list. And this is what I'm going to show in the demo. It is strictly connected with this. But I showed the demo that it should be much better. So, idea now is just to inspect the situation. What is the ranking? What is wrong? What is right? Now the idea is to try to improve the situation, assuming that you are able to change your search engine to change the result, moving something from some part to another part. And the idea is that the user wants to say, okay, this document is too high, it's in red, so it's above its real position. It's not a relevant document, it's in the top of the ranking list. I take it, I move it down, simulating a change in the software. What is going on? The user analytics part will conclude the clustering of documents, and it will move together all the similar documents to understand what will be the